like the most beautiful church, I think, on planet Earth. I'm just going to say that. I'm going to call it. Maybe a little subjective. Students, how y'all doing over there? Y'all doing okay? Okay. All right. There we are. There you are. Good. Good to see you guys. Well, I got to give a shout out to Pastor Charles. Last week, he brought week five of our best yes. So we just want to honor you, dude. You're looking good today. Yeah, so shortly after he preached last Sunday, then he went in and had four wisdom teeth taken out, and yet he's there on the front row loving students, looking good with four less teeth. So congratulations. So this morning, the Lord just throughout the course of the week really just impressed upon my heart that we need to open up our baptism up, and we need to make it available, and we have no one signed up to get baptized. But I do believe that the Lord has brought some in here today. And the Lord has been saying to you, your next yes is to celebrate what Jesus has done in your life and enter into baptism. And so maybe you're like, man, I wish I had known I would bring my shorts and my towel and my t-shirt and all the things that I need to be able to do this. We got you covered. As a matter of fact, if you get baptized, you get a free t-shirt. So we'll let you keep it because we don't want that nasty thing back after you've been in it. But today could be the day that that is your next yes. And so if you're like, man, if my mom could have been here, I totally would have done it. Well, we're going to record it. And that way she can watch it. Okay? Because nowhere in Scripture do we see someone who gets baptized who goes, I'll sign up the next time it happens so grandma and my uncle and my cat can show up and watch me do this. All right? We love your cat, we love your uncle, and we want to honor your grandma. But this is not about that. This is not about sentimental. This is about obedience. This is about making a public profession of faith. And so if the Lord wants you to say yes today, at the end of our time preaching, which is why we've kind of rearranged the service this morning, maybe you need to get rededicated. And you're like, you know what? Today's the day I'm going to rededicate my life, and I'm going to get baptized today. Then do it. So Miss Beth Ann Jackson, she's going to be by those double doors as soon as I'm done preaching. We're going to worship a little bit more so nobody grab their keys and try to think you got out early because you didn't, all right? You get exactly what you paid for today, okay? You get an hour and five-minute service, but you're going to go over during the worship time. We're going to get you suited up, and we're going to celebrate your next yes to Jesus. Amen? All right, all right. So with that said, we're finishing up the series called Our Best Yes, and I'm sad to see it go. I hope it has been a blessing to you. And if you haven't been here, the heart of this series is really centered around our mission statement, which is to exist. We exist as Christians, not as an organization, but as Christians to say yes to Jesus in every area of our lives. Because every yes that we give to Jesus paves the way for us to experience all that he came to give us so that we can walk in the fullness of our calling and our purpose on this planet so that our lives aren't wasted, but yeses to him are what paves the way. And so that is our mission statement. So we've been looking over the last couple of weeks about what it means to learn how to give the right yes in the right way so that we can experience all that God has for us. And this week, we're going to close up. And I'm going to talk to those this morning who really want to say yes to Jesus in every area of their lives, but don't feel like they can. Can anybody relate to that? I wouldn't expect any of us to raise our hands in here because we're all too churchy, right? Oh, I say yes to Jesus, and I say yes before he even asks me to do something. No, you don't. You see, the truth is, starting with your pastor, there are areas in my life today that I go, Lord, I want to say yes to you in this area, but I find that I say yes to the thing, the attitude, the behavior, the things that come out of my mouth. I say yes to them so more often than I do to him in this area. And maybe some of you this morning feel paralyzed. You're like, I can't stop. I wish I could say yes. I want to talk to you. Because some of us in here, I really do believe that some of us, maybe it's fear. Maybe it's fear that keeps us from saying yes. Maybe it's addiction that's holding us down. It could be sins. Let's be honest, right? It could be things that God says in his word are absolutely wrong, and we're still doing them. We want to say yes, just like Paul says in Romans. He says, the things I want to do, I don't do them. And the things I don't want to do, I do. Can anybody be honest enough and relate to that verse, right? It's like we want to do the right thing, but often we don't. And so what can happen is it can foster a spirit and a perspective on our salvation that is ill-informed, and we start thinking we can't say yes to Jesus. And so we even stop trying. It's for the good kids. It's for the good people. It's for the hyper bald pastor of yours. Whatever it may be. No, it's not. No, it's not. So I want to talk to you this morning. And so I want us to look at this story in John chapter 5, because it really is going to highlight where we're going this morning. This is a story that opens up with food. You can't go wrong with that. All of us just got hungry right now, right? But it opens up with this huge Jewish holiday. And there were several holidays throughout the year that were observed. And basically the whole country and the whole culture and Jerusalem shuts down completely. It's called the Festival of Feasts. How can you go wrong with that, right? Our version would be Thanksgiving coming up here in about a month or so. The Festival of Feast. It's where the recipes come out. Grandma does her thing. She makes her specialty. And so I tell you, if Israel knows how to do anything, they know how to make great food and they know how to eat. I got to go twice in 2019. And let me tell you, people go, oh, what happened? What's spiritual? I'm like, I don't know what happened spiritually. I just know that I ate better than I ever have in my life, right? That ought to tell you where my spirit is at half the time. Good food is good food. They know how to do it really well. And so they're having the Festival of Feasts. Verse 1, chapter 5. There was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went in to Jerusalem, okay? Jesus was a Jew. Jesus was raised in Jewish culture. So this is normative. This is what he would obviously be doing because he's going to observe the feast of the Jews. And it's so as he makes his way into town, I think sometimes we can just read Jesus as like this one-dimensional character, and he just goes from one thing to a good thing to a miracle to the next thing. He gets mad at religious people. They can get the, it's... He was like a, he was a human being. He's man in the, he's God in the flesh. But he got hungry, he got tired, he got thirsty, he got frustrated. As a matter of fact, scripture says of Jesus that he faced every single temptation that we have, yet did not sin. But Jesus loved a good party. That's just the truth of it. It's just the truth. You're reading scripture. His first miracle was what? Wasn't healing warts off somebody. He made more wine for people. I know, and the other half that aren't laughing, that go, you just look at the word of God and take it up with Jesus. Watch The Chosen. He does it on The Chosen too, by the way. We just got into Chosen, so forgive me if we're a little late to the party. But so Jesus is, imagine Jesus is entering into Jerusalem and the houses have the windows open and there's the smells of the food coming out of the windows, right? And there's laughter, and it's a time for family. It's a time for gathering. It's a time to remember and honor the Lord. This is a wonderful day, and Jesus is walking into Jerusalem with all of this going on. But in verse 2, it says, inside the city, near the sheep gate, everybody say sheep gate. Real significant, stick this in your back pocket. Near the sheep gate was the pool of Bethesda, with five covered porches. And so can I teach the Bible just for a little bit before we move forward? The 8:30 service didn't say a word, as if they didn't want me to preach the Bible. I don't know what they're waiting for. If they're waiting for a stand-up bit for me to do, I preach the Bible. So whether or not you want me to do it, I'm going to do it anyway, because this is amazing. Because I want you to understand the significance of what we just read. And I've preached this passage 1,000 times. Never saw it until this time. About 400 years before Jesus would walk through the sheep gate to come into Jerusalem to celebrate the feasts, there was a man by the name of Nehemiah. And Nehemiah was called by God. He was a cupbearer, and basically his only job was to make, he would take the sip of the king's wine first to make sure it wasn't poisoned. That was his gig. Can you imagine? What a job. Boring, 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 boring. Oh my gosh, I'm dead. I mean, that's kind of how the job works, okay? So that's what his job was. But the Lord chose Nehemiah. And I want to tell anybody in here this morning who feels unqualified to be used by God, or you don't feel like you've got a talent to do anything except just drink out of someone else's cup, I'm here to tell you that the Lord calls those who feel unqualified. As a matter of fact, he can use people who feel unqualified way more than people who feel like they got what it takes to do the job. May we always be in a place of need going, I don't know the answer. I have to depend fully on Jesus to make this happen as a dad, as a pastor, as a parent, as a friend, as a neighbor. It's on Jesus. We depend upon him. So Nehemiah is obedient. So his next yes to God was to go to Jerusalem and take assessment of the walls around Jerusalem because they had been fully destroyed and demolished. Every single gate had been completely unhinged. It was a mess. Nehemiah was brokenhearted to see Jerusalem in such a terrible state. So Nehemiah gets people together, all of Israel together, and in 42 days restores these walls. But part of the project was actually for him to rebuild the gates as well and restore them. The first gate that Nehemiah rebuilds was the sheep gate. The sheep gate was actually set aside and built differently from the rest of them. The sheep gate didn't have any bolts on it, and it didn't have any bars on it. And that particular gate had to be rebuilt by the high priest and the other priests. This was a special gate. This was a sacred gate. This was a gate that was consecrated out of the 10 that are mentioned in Nehemiah for a very specific purpose. All right, you track it with me? So not only that, but there was this pool of water next to the sheep gate that was made by God, consecrated for God for his purposes, so that when someone wanted to bring a sheep in through the sheep gate to go be sacrificed for the remission of sins, to cover the sins on the altar, they would have to take that sheep, put it in the pool next to the sheep gate, clean it, make it presentable for a proper offering. You just couldn't bring a nasty old dirty sheep in there and sacrifice. It had to be cleansed. The pool was right there. Okay. Let's go back now into John chapter 5 with a little bit of that context of where Jesus is coming in and where he's standing. Now, here's the other thing. He's coming into Jerusalem, and he goes through which gate? Okay, y'all, this side is with me, this side. Sorry, let's pick it up a little bit. So what gate? Thank you so much. I do appreciate it, sir. He hooked me up. But every time Jesus went into Jerusalem, he always went through the sheep gate, except the one time for his triumphant entry a week leading up to his crucifixion. Every other time he went through the sheep gate when he went into Jerusalem. So Jesus, naturally, like he always did, walks through the sheep gate during the Feast of the Festivals to come celebrate. But now he's walking by and he's standing at that pool of water we talked about that used to be able to clean sheep up to be proper offerings before the Lord. But here's the way it looks now, 400 years later. Now he walks through the sheep gate, and this pool, instead of it being used to purify sheep for sacrifices to atone for the sins of Israel, it says now in verse 3, now it's just overrun with crowds of sick people, outcasts, the forgotten, the ones who aren't in homes being fed and celebrating this feast with their family and friends. They are sick, they are blind, they are paralyzed, they are desperate, and they are lame. With that said, the eyes of Jesus begins to fall down on one particular person out of the whole group. And this man is paralyzed. We're going to learn that he's paralyzed, and he has been sick for 38 years. Now, here's the thing. We know he's been sick for 38 years, but we actually don't know how old he is. He could be in his 50s. How did he get that way? Maybe he was born that way. It's just life happens, and sometimes we're born with deformities. Maybe he was born that way. Maybe he was doing a bender as a young man, and he fell out of a window, and he paralyzed himself because he was acting a fool. Could be someone else harmed him, and all of a sudden he's paralyzed, and now something has happened to him that he didn't ask for, he didn't deserve. Regardless of how he became this way, his situation's the same nonetheless. And he is among the outcasts at this pool waiting around. But what are they waiting for? Why are they there? The reason why these people are waiting around is because they have been taught a pagan legend. And what they've been taught is the Romans believed that this pool had healing powers. Okay, so basically what they believed is the legend would say on occasion, unpredictably, what would happen is the waters would begin to bubble. And the legend was when the water began to bubble, many believed that the Greek god Asclepius what a name, the god of medicine would show up, cause the waters to bubble, and the legend was the strongest of the weak is the first one to be able to get into those waters would be healed. And so here's all of these desperate people who were laying around in this pool, and there is no evidence that anybody actually got healed. But the legend was, if you're lucky enough and you get into the water first, you can find restoration and salvation and healing for what is ailing you. That's why all these sick people are laying around. They're waiting for this water to bubble, this mysterious spiritual thing, this thing that used to be used by God to bring animal sacrifices and make them clean to be sacrificed. Now it's something other than it's just like, man, if we can just get lucky enough and I could just be one of those people. The reason why I point this out is because I think a lot of us approach our relationship with the Lord the exact same way. We see what we're not. We see the things that, you know, when you go to bed at night, have you ever laid in bed and put your head on the pillow and then begin to do a highlight reel of what a horrible person you are? One person in here is like, nope, you're a narcissist. That's why. We should reflect. But often that's when the devil shows up and goes, yeah, that's right. You are a miserable sucker. You're never going to get well. You're always going to be paralyzed by that thing. So what do? Sometimes we go, it's true. You know what? I need to get back in church. I need to get back in church. I need to start trying a little bit harder. You know what? I need to start doing more. I need to start doing better. I need to try to fix myself. I hear as a pastor people talking like that. And if you do, I understand why. Because we see the problem and we go, if I could just somehow get in the water, if I could somehow fix myself, if I could somehow bring healing into my own life, then I could be presentable to God. Then I would be a proper sacrifice, one that he's willing to accept. So we go, okay, I got to clean up. I got to put a sport coat on when I preach. I got to, whatever it may be. And we think, okay, I'm starting to get closer to the pool. I could start fixing myself. And maybe I can be one of the lucky ones that becomes the person that I desire to be, that I see others becoming. Jesus walks through the sheep gate. This paralyzed dude is laying there. He can't move. He can't get himself in the water. And so his eyes land on this paralyzed guy, and it says in verse 6, it says this, when Jesus saw the paralyzed guy, Jesus knew he had been paralyzed for a long time. How did he know that? Jesus just showed up through the sheep gate to go eat a great meal somewhere. How did he know that about that guy? The same way he knows about your illnesses of the soul. The dark secrets, the shame, the things that have paralyzed you, leading you to believe you can't get healing in that area. And you may be like the paralyzed guy, where maybe it's your fault. You put those things in your heart. You made yourself sick. And when you know what I'm talking about, I'm not talking about physical, I'm talking about spiritual. Maybe someone else did it to you. Maybe you were abused. Maybe someone hurt you. Maybe someone took advantage of you and it has paralyzed your ability to trust God or trust people. Maybe you did it yourself. Maybe you were born into a situation. I don't know. But Jesus knows. So I think some of us, we walk into context like this and we go, we think that God now sees it. And he goes, oh, well, this is okay. Now that you're here, let me just get to, okay, yeah, you got a problem. No, Scripture says that he knew all of us before the foundations of the earth were even laid. Scripture says he knew you. It says that in Jeremiah. Before you ever became a thought in your great, 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 great grandparents' mind, God already knew you. He knew that this man would be born and brought into this situation, whether by his own doing or by nature's or by something else. He knew, but there was a date with destiny. Jesus showed up. This man was not asking for it. He wasn't looking for Jesus. He didn't know who Jesus even was, but he happened to be in a place to where he could encounter Jesus. I want to tell you, for those who are watching online right now or listening by podcast or in this room, you didn't decide to come in here today. You really didn't even decide to hit play. Jesus determined he was going to show up where you were at, and he has shown up here this morning. He has. Jesus, knowing the man had been sick for this long, asks him a question. He says, do you want to get well? And I believe that is the question this morning. Not like, do you think you can do a little bit better next time? Do you think that possibly you can do your part? After all, we know the Bible says God helps those who helps themselves, right? Don't say amen. That's not in the Bible. It's right next to a penny saved as a penny earned. We have this idea that we got to pull ourselves up by our bootstraps and just try harder. Come on. Well, maybe this guy has been trying harder. Maybe he has been. But the question is not, have you been trying harder? Do you want to get healed? But the guy, through his lens of dysfunction and fear and shame and inadequacy, he says, not yes or no. Look at what he says. And guys, this is where a lot of us get stuck. As Christians, this is where we get stuck. Look at the first two words. Say it out loud. He says, yep. God says, your next yes is to get baptized this morning. I can't. I'm going to mess up my hair. Listen, I'm a bald guy. I don't care. It's your problem. At least you got hair to mess up. The Lord has been saying, I need you to step in and maybe serve in kids ministry. I can't. I don't have the temperament for that. Jesus is saying to you, you need to be more patient with your spouse. Quit flying off the handle. It's not about you. I can't. You need to practice better business practices. That one just came to me. That came from the Lord for someone in here. But I can't. I'm going to cut my income in half if I actually do it that way. Do you see how we do this? We exist to say yes to Jesus in every area of our lives, except the areas that we don't think we can. Do you see how this works? God is saying, build a little secret space. Find that time. Meet with me there. If you want to know more of who I am and what I've called you to do, meet me there. Read the Word of God. Pray, just like we talked about a couple of weeks ago. I can't get up that early. I can't. Those two words will paralyze a Christian. I can't. I can't. I can't. I used to work for a boss, and I used to say, he'd say something like, hey, I need you to do X, Y, and Z. And sometimes, I'd look at my calendar and be like, I can't. He said, don't tell me you can't. Tell me you won't. Well, how are you going to tell your boss, I won't do that? He got me every time. Don't tell me you can't. So parents, you're welcome. That was the parent seminar right there. The next time they say, I can't do it. Don't tell me you can't. Tell me you won't. And if you tell me you won't, you're restricted. I'm taking your phone away. Okay. Oh, that's what we applaud on? That's what we applaud on. Improvisation. There we go. All right. I can't what? Okay, let's get back to the Word of God, y'all. The guy thinks Jesus is asking, why haven't you already gotten healed? Why haven't you already gotten your stuff together? You've been this way 38 years. Isn't it about time you start fixing your problems? That's how the guy's hearing it. But Jesus isn't asking that question, but he goes into a reason. He goes on to say, he says, I have no one to help me. I don't have support in my life. I have no friends. No one puts me in the pool when the water bubbles up. Someone always gets there in front of me. I can't do it. I can't get healing. There's always someone more beautiful, someone more talented. There's always someone who always gets the good breaks. I can't get there. They always get what I'm trying to get. And he's right. He's right. From his perspective, that is true. Everybody else can run out of hell. You may be blind, but at least your legs work. You could jump in the water and get healing. This dude is stuck. And he's saying, I'm on my own, and the stronger people are always getting what I'm dying to get. What he's saying is I don't have what it takes. And guess what? Neither do you. Neither do I. The truth is spiritually speaking, we are all lame. We are all blind. We are all paralyzed. We are only deceiving ourselves if we think that somehow we can make ourselves justifiable before God because we try hard. And I even feel that even during the worship time this morning, maybe you're looking around going, how come all these other people can have an experience with God? I can't. They have what I can't seem to get. I wish I could have the passion of Pastor David. I wish I could have the passion of the people in front of me worshiping. They're crying and I'm standing there going, I just don't even know what I'm doing. Do you know what I'm talking about? Have you ever been in a room or a situation like that? You're like, well, how am I keep continuing to miss this? But Jesus said one time, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. What was he saying? Do you know what he actually is saying? Blessed are those who are willing to admit they don't have what it takes, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. People who feel they can look at their spiritual pedigree and resume, look at all the areas I serve, look how much I give, look how much I do all these things. What they're saying is, I found a way to jump in the pool on my own strength and cleanse myself. Look how good I am now. The kingdom of heaven does not belong to that spirit. The kingdom of heaven belongs to those who go only but by the grace of God. Am I able to take another breath to see another day? So Jesus goes, I'm reading into it. This is extra biblical. This is what the people on YouTube call eisegesis, okay? So what I'm doing here is I'm supposing something in here that's not written. However, Jesus makes a decision not to circle back and ask him the question again. He goes, do you want to get healed? I can't, because all these people who are lucky enough to be able to get blah, 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 blah. Jesus just goes, stand up and pick up your mat and walk. Let's quit beating around the bush. Let's quit blaming folks. Let's quit looking at ourselves and I can't and I'm this and I'm that. Jesus is saying, I'm here. You don't have to get in the water. I'm going to heal you. Get up, take your mat, and walk. Get moving. That's all. And it was just like, boom. And look what it says. The next word, instantly. Instantly. It was not progressive. Jesus saves you all at once. Now, the process of sanctification is learning how to walk in the healing that he's given us through salvation. Sanctification means it is a process where we look less and less like ourselves and more like Jesus as we follow Jesus and say yes to him. But just because you're saved does not mean that you're still not laying on that mat in some area. Some of us, we get saved and we stay on the mat. We don't get up and walk into that which God has for us. This is why someone can know Jesus for 30 years and they're just as nasty and immature and bitter as the day that they said yes to Jesus. What happened? They stayed on the mat. They didn't start walking. They didn't take the command. What kind of healing does it really say that we've received if we get that healing and our thanks to the Lord is just to keep laying there as if we're still paralyzed? We're called to walk, guys. Christians, you were called to walk. This is what it means to say yes to Jesus in every area of our lives. And that dude got healed that day, and he rolled up his sleeping mat, and he began to walk. God is so good. Jesus is good. And the same Jesus that we're reading about right here is here present in this room this morning. His spirit is here, and you know it. Why do I share this story with you? Because I believe there are many of us that truly deep down want to say yes to Jesus. And we have overcomplicated this thing. And so we go, I can't because I don't know how. I get that and I've been there. But before we finish up and we open up the baptismal waters for you to get baptized this morning, because you already know the Lord's told you to do it and this is your next yes. We'll get to that in a second. Can we go back to the sheep gate just one more time? Because there's something else I want to share with you about this. Why did Jesus make it a point to only go through the sheep gate when he went to Jerusalem? He could have gone to any of them. Why only that one? Because that gate, for 400 years, prophesied about him. And Jesus was the only one qualified and had the right to walk through that gate. In the way that he did. He went through the gate that was belonged to him, that was built for him to walk through. Jesus explains it this way in John 10. He says, I tell you the truth. He said, anyone, everybody say, what does that word say? Anyone, any of y'all, Regardless of how you walked in here this morning, regardless of how you see yourself in your living room watching on streaming right now, regardless of how you hear this right now in your car on podcast, Jesus says, anyone, you, paralyzed, the weakest of the weak, wanting to find cleansing, wanting to find restoration, anyone. He goes on to say, though, that there are those who will come and tell you the way to your healing is to be able to, you got to fix yourself. You got to buy a self-help book. You got to take a dumb Enneagram test. You need to jump on YouTube and you need to Google some gurus to figure out how to live your life. Those people are wall jumpers. They are not your savior. Those tests do not tell you what you are. They actually just are designed to point out what is broken in your life so Jesus can heal it. But they are not personality diagnostics. The people on YouTube are great folks, half of them, but you can't, they are not the good shepherd. They cannot, are qualified to walk through the gate of the sheep. Jesus says, anyone who sneaks over the wall of that sheepfold, rather than going through the gate, must surely be a thief and a robber. Jesus is about to make a distinction. It says, but the one, Jesus says, who enters through the what? The gate is the shepherd of the sheep. That's why Jesus walked through the sheep gate every time he went to Jerusalem, because he is the good shepherd. And he walked through the gate set aside for him. And he was the only one that had the right to be able to do it with this level of authority. And he came to the sick sheep who had no ability to clean themselves up, had no ability to get into the water, had no ability to present themselves as a worthy sacrifice and offering to the Lord. We couldn't do it. We're the sick people waiting for healing, looking for something. And Jesus says, you don't have to get in the water. I will come to you. And I'm showing up here. Jesus said, look, I did not come for the healthy. He said, who have no need of a physician. He said, no. He says, I've come for those who are sick. He's talking about us. He said, I did not come to call the righteous, but the sinners who recognize their sin and humbly seek my forgiveness. That's what Jesus said he came to do. And so for those who's listening this morning, whose souls have been devastated by sin, devastated by your own shame and your regrets that have left you paralyzed, spiritually speaking, I'm here to tell you something. Jesus, the good shepherd, is inviting anyone who is listening to come through his gate to find salvation and healing for your soul. Because he always goes on to finish the statement in John 10. He says, Jesus said, yes, I'm the gate. Jesus said, I am that gate. Those who come in through me will be saved. They will come and they will go freely and they will find good pastures. He says, I'm the good shepherd, and the good shepherd sacrifices his life for those sheep. Right now, Jesus is at the sheep gate of your life. And he's saying, will you come through? Let me heal you. Let me restore you. Here's the thing. Jesus, seeing that we had no ability to walk into the waters and clean ourselves up, it doesn't wash it off, does it? Jesus, understanding that we had no ability to cleanse ourselves, the good shepherd became the sheep, the only one worthy. And he laid down his life and he allowed his blood to be shed on the altar, so that the sick sheep could be healed through salvation by his blood. So not only is he the good shepherd, he became the sacrificial lamb. He did it all. When we understand this and we exchange our life for the life of Christ and we put our faith in that reality that we can't save ourselves, look what happens in 2 Chronicles or 2 Corinthians 2. Chapter 5, verse 17, it says this. This means, what does this mean? This means anyone who belongs to Christ, look at what it says, has become a new creation, a new person, paralyzed, forgotten about, not invited to the home to have the feast with a family, hoping that some good luck, that some fake God would show up and fix you. When you exchange that nonsense for the truth of the good shepherd saying, come through the gate, you become a new person immediately, just like we saw the man being healed. What happens is, look, this is the good news of Jesus. The old life, your old life, is what? Well, it's pending until we see how you handle the salvation thing. Is that what it says? No, it is gone. It's covered. It's dead. It's a memory now. It's your testimony. A new life begins when you say yes to Jesus. And all of this is a gift from God who brought us back to himself through Christ. Jesus is not only the good shepherd. He became the sacrificial lamb for you. He was spotless, he was worthy, and he laid his life down. And his blood is what cleanses you, not water. It's blood and the water combination that we see is what we're saved by. For God made Christ, go to the next one, God made Christ, who never sinned, to be the offering for our sins so that we may become right with God through the gate, Jesus. So this morning, whether you're listening, whether you're in this room this morning, here's the question now for you. If all this is true, then the question is no longer, can you get your stuff together and do better? No. The question is do you want this? Do you want to be healed? And when I say healed, I'm speaking specifically to be made worthy to be loved by God through Christ. To have a new life start today. What would it look like if you walked in here with all those things that have paralyzed you up to this point, and now you're able to walk out a new creation? Is there anybody in here who says, I am that new creation? I've done what he's saying you can do. Has anybody received Christ this morning and become a new creation in Christ? Let me see a show of hands. Put your hand up if you're saved. Okay. Maybe you weren't able to put your hand up and you're like, I want to be saved, but I thought that being a good person is what did it. What do I do? What must I do to be saved? In Acts chapter 2, Peter, who was not once known for being a knucklehead, is now filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. And he begins to preach boldly. And he begins to explain to the Jews. He says, look, you are the ones who crucified him. And he begins to say that it was all of our sins, Jews and Gentiles, that nailed Jesus to the cross. And it goes on to say, they were like, it says their hearts were pierced. And they were grieved at the idea that this spotless lamb, the good shepherd, was the one who went to the cross and died a criminal's death on our behalf, even though we were the ones who were sick. We were the ones who were the lawbreakers. Then what must I do to be saved? And this is what he says. You ready? He says, repent. He says, change your old way of thinking. That's what it means to repent. Turn from your old sinful ways, accept and follow Jesus as the Messiah. We're going to stop right there for a second. And so this morning, if you want to be saved, if you want to exchange your illnesses, your infirmities, your sin for the life and the forgiveness and the wholeness of Jesus, as you are, you can ask for it. Do you want to be saved? If you want to be saved, pray with me right now. Dear Jesus, tell it to him right now. He's listening and he's here. Take advantage of this opportunity. This may be the only time you get one. Pray with me. Dear Jesus, I admit that I'm a sinner. I repent of my sins. I believe you died on the cross for my sins. I believe you rose from the dead on the third day. And I'm asking you to save me. I make you the Lord and God of my life. Fill me with your Holy Spirit and give me your new life. In Jesus' name. And if you prayed that prayer right now and you meant it from the bottom of your heart, whether it's in the comments below or you send us an email, or to those in this room, if you just prayed that prayer at the count of three, I want you to raise your hand. 1, 2, 3. If you just received Christ as your Savior and you just prayed this morning, lift your hand. Where's it at? Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. God bless you. It's good. It's good. Anybody else? Anybody else in here? God bless you, man. God bless you. Look at what Peter says on the other side. Everybody now look at me. Look at me. No. But look at what he says now. In light of us receiving Christ, he says, repent and what? Be baptized, each of you, in the name of Jesus Christ. Why? Because of the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. It says in the second chapter of Acts. Our yes requires a response and an action. That's the next point. Go on and put that up. Our yes requires an action and a response. Not for our salvation, but we respond to the reality of what has just happened in our spirits. And so for those of you who have received Christ this morning, or maybe you're in a place in your life where you've gone back to the mat at some point recently, and you've gone back and you've allowed your mat, because mats are comfortable, and maybe you are a Christian, but you have gone back and you've laid down in an addiction again, or a mindset, or a perspective, or a way of thinking that has paralyzed you again. Well, this morning, what I'm here to tell you is Jesus is saying, pick up your mat and walk. For those of you this morning that want to rededicate your life, or you've never been baptized, this is what Christians, that's your next yes to Jesus. That is it. Why do you want to do it? It's a celebration. Baptism is a celebration of old things, dead things, being made new and being brought to new life in Christ. And so we're going to stand. We're going to worship. We have two songs that we're going to worship. This is not your time to grab your keys. This is part of the service. But right now, our baptism team, if you can raise your hands up real high back there, it is time to celebrate what Jesus has done in your life and get baptized. We got everything set up. All we need and all you need is a yes and a step. And so I'm going to ask you to go back to those doors right now as we worship in the next song. Time to get baptized. Time to stir the waters. Time to celebrate what Jesus has done for you in your life. And I want to finish with this one verse. You see, baptism is an expression of a believer's new life in Christ. It now saves you, not by removing dirt from your body, but as an appeal to God for a good, clear conscience. Baptism demonstrates what we believe to actually be ours through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Take advantage of this opportunity right now. Let's celebrate and continue to worship.